In the last episode, you have seen how archaeology, when there was a difference of opinion among two groups of historians, how archaeology could solve the problem by its own tools, that is, exploration and excavation. By excavating a structure from the womb of earth and comparing that structure with a painting of Akbar's time, we could solve the problem very amicably. Now the next episode is about the discovery of the Christian chapel at Fatehpur Sikri. When the Christian fathers came to Fatehpur Sikri, initially they were accommodated in a sarai. Then they were shifted to another place near Hathiyapol in Fatehpur Sikri. But in all the religious discussions, Akbar was favoring the Christian fathers. So there was a feeling among Muslims that Akbar would be converted into Christianity. And the fathers also felt that Akbar is on the verge of conversion into Christianity. If this pagan, the master of many unsaved souls, is converted into Christianity, then the whole country would be converted into Christianity. That is what they had hoped for. But Akbar was a different man. One day he was worshipping like that of a Hindu. Second day like that of a Muslim. Third day like that of a Christian. Fourth day like that of a Jain. Fifth day like that of a Parsi. So they felt that this man, he doesn't believe in any religion at all. So there were two fathers, as we said earlier. One was Father Rodolfo Cavaiva, who was the leader of the team. He was an Italian. And the second man was Father Monserrat, who was a Spanish man. He wrote a book known as Mongolike Legationis Commentarius, in which he has given the description of that small chapel which Akbar had built for them. So he has given some clues also in that book. In this episode, we are going to watch how the clues given by Father Monserrat in his book known as Mongolike Legationis Commentarius is being used by an archaeologist as a tool for the exploration and excavation of the first chapel of North India. So please watch and enjoy the Investigative Archaeology episode number 2. We are demystifying archaeology for the general public during the lockdown period. Thank you so much.
After the successful discovery of Ibadat Khana and various other structures in Fatehpur Sikri, Mr. K.K. Muhammad, then a young archaeologist, turned his attention for the location of Christian chapel.
An archaeologist is basically in search of the remains and relics of a forgotten culture or a lost empire. But there is a methodology which he essentially follows, from known to unknown.
If the discovery of Ibadat Khana was made on the basis of a Mughal painting, the location of the Christian chapel was with the help of a reference in a book titled Mongolica Legationis Commentarius by Father Monserrat, who was an occupant of this chapel.
So he very clearly says that this particular chapel, it was outside the palace boundary. So I followed the palace boundary and then there was a door. So I stopped near the doorway. Why doorway? Because doorway has got its own importance. Because Father Monserrat again says that Akbar had made one doorway specifically for this one, for facilitating the easy entry and exit of the fathers. Because there was a reason for that one. Because there was a widespread belief that Akbar is on the verge of the conversion. So naturally the whole Muslim public would be against them. But there was one more reason, not only the Muslims, even the Rajput ladies were also against fathers, for the reason that in the eventuality of Akbar being converted into Christianity, as per the Christian law, that he will have to divorce all the wives except the senior most one.
So the Rajput ladies were also against them. So Akbar thought that somebody would make an attempt on the life of these fathers. So he wanted to keep them very close to his palace. And then at the same time, Akbar enjoyed this kind of philosophical discussion with fathers. That was a kind of obsession for him. So he doesn't want to stop that one. So just outside this door, I saw a small mound. So when we excavated, I mean it was in the year 1982 and 83 when we excavated, and when we completed the work, we got two rooms. And then I wrote a letter to Archbishop of Agra, Dr. Cecil D'Souza. He came, he saw, he was not very much impressed. So he said that they have got certain information with them, according to which this chapel of North India, this had three rooms, whereas the one we got has got only two. So we explained that is we are only halfway through the excavation. We also expect that this large room would be further divided into two. So what we did is that we again excavated that portion and we could get three rooms. And the Archbishop was very much satisfied, but we were not satisfied on our side. Because for us, we had to prove that not only that three rooms, but we had to prove that this was the actual chapel itself. From the very beginning, I had no hope of getting any ritualistic thing associated with Christianity, like the Holy Cross or the icons of the Christian saints and other things. For the simple reason, all the fathers had left Fatehpur Sikri by 1583. And Fatehpur Sikri continued as the capital up to 1585. Since the chapel had occupied a very prominent place, most probably Akbar might have used it for some other kind of purpose. So the only thing is to prove that this was Khushbu Khana, because Father Monserrat, who was an occupant, has specifically said that it was this Khushbu Khana which was converted into chapel. So I had to prove that this was Khushbu Khana. And very fortunately, our meticulous excavation yielded Zirre Itardan, that is the perfume bottle. And then once the bottle was recovered, I compared it with a late Mughal painting of perfume bottles. It was remarkably similar.
And that perfume was made over here?
That perfume was made over
here. So did we find anything which can prove that perfume was made here?
Yes, that is the most clinching evidence we got here. Because you know, the real perfume furnace itself we could excavate.
Which we never thought that we would be able to get that perfume furnace itself. And it was this perfume. Oh, interesting. And when we got that kadai, that furnace, it was as fresh as it was done during the time of Akbar himself. Mm. If there was kadai, there must be some fireplace.
Yes. The fireplace is just below this one. So it was through this one fire was set. And it would be boiling there on top of it. And then that would be conveyed and the distillation will be taking place there. And this again, there was another Mughal painting of Jahangir's time. It is known as Murakkaya Gulshan painting, which is now housed in Tehran Museum. We compared that painting along with this one. It was looking similar to the one which we have excavated. So all this proves that this was the Khushbu Khana, which was converted into the church, and everything was as per the information given by Father Monserrat in his Mongolic legation, his commentaries.
So is there a reference anywhere that it was the Khushbu Khana that was converted into the chapel or was built over the Khushbu Khana?
Yes, of course. I mean, we have the references also. This might be because, you know, since it was Khushbu Khana, the flooring might have been completely soiled with all kinds of oils and other things. So when it was converted into church, Akbar most probably he might have given a new flooring. So I broke a portion of that flooring. So below that one, I could get the real flooring of the Khushbu Khana, and the new flooring was given by Akbar when it was converted into the chapel. That way we could prove that this was the kind of repair work which Akbar had carried out.
Although the fathers were very close to Akbar, they failed in converting Akbar to Christianity, as he was not a man of single religion. The fact that he was indulging in sun worship daily like devout Hindu, and at other times worshipping like Jains and Parsis further confused them. In one of the letters written to Jesuit General in Rome, fathers write that perhaps he doesn't believe in any religion at all. Failed in their mission, the fathers went back to Goa, much against Akbar's will. Akbar sent an escort and ensured that they reach Goa without any problem. But in Portuguese Goa, at a place known as Concolim, they were killed by a group of people. Akbar heard the news of martyrdom of Father Rudolph with tears in his eyes and murmured, "Alas, Father, did I not tell you not to go away? But you would never listen to me."
The discoveries at Fatehpur Sikri, like Ibadat Khana with the Christian chapel and the huge bazaar of Akbar's time, because I worked in Fatehpur Sikri almost for 9 years. So all these things finally secured me a posting in Archaeological Survey of India. And my second posting was in Goa. So I thought that I should utilize this opportunity to locate the mortal remains of Father Rudolph Akoveva, whom I had met in Fatehpur Sikri. So one day I was surveying the entire antiquities and other items housed in, say, Cathedral Church. I was along with Father Titonia D'Souza, who is an independent authority on Indo-Portuguese history. There in Say Cathedral Church, in the Chapel of Holy Ghost, we found an old worn-out casket.
Curiosity drew Mr. Muhammad and Father Titonia D'Souza towards it. Lo and behold, here's the bone pieces of Father Rudolph Akoveva and fellow martyrs who were killed at Concolim in Goa. Martyrs of Concolim is clearly written on it. To be doubly sure whether this specifically contained the bones of Father Rudolph, when Mr. Muhammad inspected the second inscription on the lower part, he was further blown over his feet to see the name of the blessed Akoveva written over it. Recalling his outstanding discovery of church in Fatehpur Sikri and the bones of the fathers many hundreds of miles away in Goa, Mr. Muhammad comments that in archaeology, along with hard work, luck also plays an important role.